animal torture on at least three occasions while a student at the Kansas City, while in front of students at the Kansas City Institute. Two of those, he tortured a duck and a chicken in front of his friends. And in the third instance, he experimented with sedatives and tranquilizers on a dog.
Oh.
Sounds a little bit cruel, even for the sake of art.
A little bit.
Even for the sake of art. Yeah, I mean, like, Damien Hirst put animals in, like, the formaldehyde, right? But I don't think he killed them to do it. I think they're, like, already dead. I don't know.
But I don't know.
It pissed off vegans either way. the tranquilizer thing with the dog, that is a skill he would later come to use on much larger subjects. In 1969, he voluntarily withdrew from the Kansas City Art Institute after receiving harsh criticism from the college administrators for killing, then cooking the duck for the sake of art. I don't get why the cooking would be for the sake of art. Why don't you just eat?
I presume it would be just a killing, right?
I don't know. I probably cooked it in some stupid... Oh, maybe. Oh, no. Killing, then cooking. I don't know. I don't know. I don't get this type of art. He chose to remain in Kansas... Pardon?
Me don't know.
Oh, me don't know.
Not like that.
I don't know. He chose to remain in Kansas City, and in September of that same year, he moved into an address located within the Hyde Park district of Kansas City, an address known as 4315 Charlotte Street. Just to note, this is where he would just stay now. So he's just there.
Okay.
Oh, do you want to see a picture? Do you want to see a picture?
Yeah.
Don't look at the screen. Don't look at the screen. Don't look at the screen. That's his house.
Oh.
4315 Charlotte Street, as it appears today.
It reminds me of Halloween.
It does look a bit like the Halloween house, a little bit, if it was just a little bit bigger. And it would need the centralised door. Actually, it doesn't look anything like the one, finally. No, it does.
I just give him, like, the day.
It does. I can get what you mean. Oh, did you know? Quick fact of the day: the same street where the house on Halloween was filmed is the same street where the house from Teen Wolf was filmed.
I thought it was Back to the Future, but
no,
I know they are. It was just
Michael J. Fox.
Yes,
I love Michael J. Fox so much. Please, if there is a God and I need my religious awakening, make it so that Michael J. Fox never dies. Once that happens, I will believe.
But you'll die.
Oh.
So if Michael J. Fox would just live forever.
Yeah, but if I outlive him, then I'm going to know, all right? I'm going to know something's a little fresher. Fishy with Fox. Robert was openly gay, which in 1969, I guess it was still frowned upon, but you've swinging 60s, free love.
I don't know
Jimi
how
Hendrix,
the laws
Van
went,
Halen.
To be fair.
Van Halen was 60. No, it wasn't. I'm just thinking.
He's just thinking of bands in the 60s.
I'm just saying 60s bands. All I'm thinking is, like, it's frowned upon by the general public, maybe, but, you know, it's not the worst thing. Because swinging 60s, everyone was, like, free love, and everyone was fucking everyone in the 60s, right? I mean, they were all on fucking meth and heroin, but...
Yeah.
And also, you know, got glam rocks just rumbling around the corner, so it's not the worst. Still illegal, though, I think. He started hanging out with drug addicts, petty criminals, and male sex workers and runaways. Oh, I don't think it was. I don't know about the illegal thing. I don't know. Robert said that he felt compelled to try to help these people free them from their drug addictions and criminal lifestyles. He loaned them money. And let most of them live in his home rent free. But it's known that for at least several of the men, this was only on the terms that he could have sex with them. So I don't know how good of a deal that really is. Free home, free food. Gotta fuck this dude. Do you know what he looks like at this point, by the way? Do you want to show you?
I presume that first picture that he used, that dog.
Y'all. Guys, by the way, one of the other reasons why you should. So go follow us on Facebook is because all the pictures that we talk about today, well, not all the pictures we're going to talk about today, some of the pictures we talk about in the Alan's face is looking at me very suspicious, but We do put pictures that we do reference in the podcast on our Facebook page. Just search for us, Adventures in Midland.
Unless they are graphic, then we won't.
They get a little bit... Yes.
To be fair, can I just say, he looks like a normal dude,
but that's what they always fucking say. He seemed like a normal member of society, respectable member of society. And then you find out everything. It's always the fucking case. That's why you should only trust weird-looking people like me. You're not weird-looking.
No.
No?
I don't know. I don't know if you am.
You're not weird-looking. No. Now it's at this point in 1981 or 1982-ish, he starts the Bob's Bizarre Bazaar that we mentioned earlier. He began renting his own booth at the Westport Flea Market, and primarily sold and traded in primitive art, jewellery and antiques. At the market, he met another... Oh, do you want to see... Oh, no, I want to do it now. Oh, no, I will. I'll show you the little calling card thing from the Bob's Bazaar Bazaar. How cute!
Oh.
That's his little, card that he would give people.
That's cute.
It's cute, right? I'll leave that there. At the flea market, he met another dude with a stall named Paul Howell. Paul operated a booth just opposite his. Paul was married with a younger son called Jerry Howell, and Robert became pretty good friends with all of them, with the whole family. Paul's kind of like that, like dad's mate sort of thing, but he's quite close. Paul's son, Jerry, apparently used to take the piss out of Robert for being gay. But apparently, according to Robert, Jerry had admitted to him at one point that he had, on occasion, done some male sex work for money.
Oh.
When times are hard, get hard, right?
Oh.
Is that not the phrase you should use? When times are hard, no. Fuck! Put that shit on a t-shirt! on July 5th, 1980, does that tickle you a little bit? On July 5th, that was off the top of the dome as well, that wasn't even noted down. On July 5th, 1984, Jerry, and this is, you need to stop laughing now.
I have.
Oh, immediately. Wow, you can really turn that on and off. Makes me wonder if it was ever real in the first place. Jerry, who was, I think, 19 at the time, apparently wanted to go to a dancing contest in Miriam. I googled where that was, and apparently it's like 20-minute drive from
Kansas
City. Sounds
like a name.
Does, doesn't it, Miriam? I googled that. It's like 20-minute drive from Kansas City, so probably too far to walk, but not far at all to drive.
Yeah.
Robert, now being a close family friend, volunteered to drive Jerry, which Jerry agreed to. Jerry went over to Robert's house, and Robert offered him a drink before they set off in the car. Probably just like, you know, fancy a few little brewskis before you set off, get yourself a bit loosey-goosey before you go to the dance thing. He said, yeah, mate, come on. Cut to Robert now plying Jerry with more alcohol, along with Valium and Esopromazine.
What's that?
I thought, you know what? Because
you
always ask me
you that question, so I thought you'd have the answer to it.
You ask me. I find I do so much research, and you always ask me questions to things that I don't know the answers to. So I'm going through this and thinking, what is the questions that Alan would ask me? So I've actually found that out for you.
Oh, so you actually did find it out.
I found
for
it
me.
Out because I knew that you would be an awkward fuck and ask me this question about fucking chemicals and shit. And I thought, you've caught me out so many times before. Not today, Satan. apparently, it's a derivative antipsychotic drug. It was tested on humans in the 1950s as an antipsychotic, but is now exclusively used on animals as a sedative. So it's a very strong sedative. Jerry, after obviously he was dosed with all those things, soon became unconscious, where Robert proceeded to inject him with an even heavier tranquilizer before binding him to his bed, where he would remain for the next 28 hours.
Oh my God.
Oh, you think that's bad?
So, have you got a picture of this Jerry person?
I do, yeah. Jerry How? Oh. He looks like a really... He looks like the typical all-American kid, right? Whom?
Robin Williams in Mork and Mindy.
Oh! Yeah, I can kind of see that. Yeah, like young Robin Williams, but a little bit more, like, classically attractive as
Yeah.
well. Yeah, I can see that. Oh, R.I.P. Robin Williams. But anyway...
R.I.P. this... Jerry.
Well, you don't know yet.
I'm guessing, so...
Throughout the 28 hours Jerry was kept, Robert repeatedly drugged, tortured, raped, and violated Jerry with foreign objects. Robert repeatedly ignored Jerry's intermittent questioning as to why he was being treated that way and stayed silent during his pleas to be freed. According to Robert, Jerry then... quote-unquote, either asphyxiated on his own vomit or the combination of the gag and the medicines were too strong for him to be able to catch breath.
Ah, so suffocated.
Suffocated or sort of drowned himself in his own sick. It's fucking horrible. Oh. Look at that. That's horrible. Robert stated that he did briefly attempt to perform CPR on Jerry after he died, obviously unsuccessfully, and then he dragged his body into the basement. And then it gets worse. He then suspended the body above a large cooking pot and made several incisions to his inner elbows and jugular vein before leaving the body suspended in the same position overnight to allow the blood to drain out.
What?
So he pretty much killed him, hung him upside down like you would like a cattle.
Yeah.
Slit his throat, slit his underarms, slit his elbows, and then he just bled out.
Oh my god.
What a fucking tragedy. The following day, he dismembered the body using a chainsaw. Chainsaw, fucking brutal. That's fucking brutal. Before wrapping the sections in newspaper and trash bags. These bags were later placed inside larger trash bags, which Robert placed outside for a garbage crew to collect and take to a landfill.
A bit brazen, isn't it?
Very much so. But, fuck, like... chopping with a chainsaw. That's like a horror movie.
That makes sense with what you just said.
Oh, with the fact that he was with the fucking collector. He was taking a drink. Was like,
what a douche.
We need to think of more insulting words for these guys. I mean, I can think of a few, but I think people get offended by certain words. I think twat is a good word, right? Twat? Then again, twat's like something you call somebody who, like, kicks you or something like that. Not someone who fucking chainsaws you. When later questioned... so obviously, Jerry was last seen with Robert.
Yeah.
So the police obviously took him for questioning. Yeah. When questioned, Robert said that he had driven Jerry to Merriam, as promised, and that he dropped him off just down the road from the dance place, but he said he hadn't seen him since. Police just carried on investigating. He just became another sort of statistic in missing persons cases, I guess, for a good while. Obviously not to his family, friends and parents. Yeah. It was fucking tragic. Which, side note, when I went to America, I don't know if you saw this, but in Walmart, there was like a cork board on the wall just near the entrance. And it's
missing people.
Yeah, always stuck with me. Because you never see that in England. I know for a fact people go missing in England. But the sheer amount of faces on that wall, and that was just one fucking Walmart.
Yeah. They do it in England. There's, you know, in the city centre of Manchester, there's a massive television, and you just...
They put them on there. Yeah, they put I've them seen on there, them. But this, I just remember, like, all these... I remember, because I was only, like, maybe 16, 17 at the time. I remember seeing all these fucking faces.
No, me too, yeah. It was like... It was about 20 at least.
It reminds me of that film with Halle Berry in, where she goes into the police station after her daughter goes missing, and she goes, "We'll just file her apart," and then she looks over at the corkboard and she sees all the other children's missing faces, and she's like, "No, I'm gonna do something about this shit."
Yeah, I know. I can't remember what it's called now. It wasn't a daughter, it was a son.
Oh, your son. Well, we digressed, but still, you should go watch that movie. I think we needed a little chill from that description. On April 10th, 1985, a former lodger of Robert's, 23-year-old Robert Sheldon, I got